The Jewish Heritage Project presents The Spring of Judea and Samaria. Today you will be a witness to the rise of the ancient Hebrew civilization on the land where it first began. And now today, in 2012, for the first time, the Jewish world and beyond will meet face to face with the Jews of Judea and Samaria and hear from those that are changing the Jewish world on the so-called West Bank land. This is the land where the Jewish nation was born and central to the promises that our fathers received from God that one day their descendants would inherit this land. It is essential that the 40 years of slander and misunderstanding against the Jews living on the land of Judea and Samaria be undone. These pioneers must have a chance to tell their side of the story so that the world, Jews and non-Jews alike, can meet these people as they really are. And now, despite most of the world being against them, they have succeeded with tremendous faith, dedication, and strength to create noble communities and a flourishing Jewish culture. This is the spring of Judea and Samaria.
Shalom. I'm glad to have you at my home, and I will save some time, I hope, by presenting myself. My name is Daniela Weiss. I'm living here in Kedumim, which used to be Elon More 35 years ago. I am a member of Garin Elon More, the Garin, the group that started Jewish life, renewed Jewish life in modern time, here in Shomron, on this hill, this beautiful hill now, but when I came here with the group, it was just a bare hill. I came with my husband and my two daughters then, Yaeli and Shira, and we started in tents, we moved to shacks, we moved to trailers, no infrastructure, then moved to another kind of house, and today we live in this, thank God, beautiful house. The things that makes me the happiest in the world is that my daughters and my 17, Baruch Hashem, grandchildren continue in the way of settlement.
So we are standing here in a historic spot, and you're looking at the sign which is telling the story of the beginning of the establishment of the communities in Shomron. The sign is called the stage of Menachem Begin, because on this stage, after Dumim was established and he was elected, he came here to announce the legality of the communities, and that was the first place he came to visit after he was elected. So the sign is telling the story of the beginning of the communities established in Shomron. As you all know, until 1975 there was no Jewish presence in Judea and Shomron. There were only a group of people in Kiryat Arba that managed to establish a stronghold in Kiryat Arba, and then the same group, they established a group called Gush Emunim, the faithful people for Eretz Israel. From all of the country they formed a group that said we have to settle Shomron, and they tried to settle and had no permission. We came seven times, time after time, the group of the faithful, and we tried to settle around Shechem. Between 73 and 75, 1975, seven times people came to settle around Shechem. every time we came with equipment and children and supporters, and every time we managed to build something, and the government ordered the army to evacuate. The last time, Hanukkah 1975, thousands of Jews joined the original nuclear, the group, Garin Elon Moré, it was called, because we wanted to come to Shechem. Elon Moré is written in Parashat Lech Lecha, the first place Avraham came, Vayavor Avraham Ba'aretz, Vayavor Ad Mekom Shechem, Ad Elon Moré. This is why we called ourselves Garin Elon Moré. We wanted to settle next to Shechem, and we were called Garin Elon Moré. 1975, we ended in the railway station of Sebastia, which is north of here, north of Kdumim today. It is north of Shechem. That place is actually the original biblical city Shomron, which was the capital city of the 10 tribes, the kingdom of Israel. There are remnants there of that time, of the capital city. We came there, and thousands of people came, and the government had a problem. What to do with the amount of people, the support, the people from America that supported the leadership of the Jewish people. And they said, okay, we can't resist this determination. We will let 30 people out of this group to stay in the army camp Kadum, which is beneath this community, an army camp. They will stay there, and we will decide what to do with this group. And this was actually the beginning of Kdumim.
You are looking at the second attempt to establish a Shomron community. In the background is Mount Gerizim and Mount Ebal. The camp was established 2 years after Kdumim, and named Elon Moré. The camp was moved after permission was granted to establish a community at the location of the present-day community of Elon Moré.
Okay, my name is Zev Safer, and we came here to Elon Moré right from the beginning in 1980. We started on this spot, and we were then about 10 families. We chose this spot because in the Torah it mentions that Avraham Avinu, when he came into the land for the first time, God showed him where to go, and he came to Elon Moré, and this is where God promised to Avraham that to his children he will give this land. So we felt it's very important to renew the Jewish presence in this area. When the Jewish people came in to this area right after they left Egypt, they came to this very spot here between Mount Gerizim and Mount Ebal, which is off to the left. And that's where they became a nation, where they received the blessings and the curses, and built Joshua's Mizbeach, altar on Har Ebal. And this is very important to us as Jews, that we have come back to our homeland, back to the land that God promised to the Jewish people.
My name is Shoshana Shiloh. I'm living in Kdumim, the first Jewish settlement, for 33 years old. And I want to tell you about our life. When we came here, we felt that we opened the way to Jewish life in Shomron, but we didn't think about the price we are going to pay. Then we paid a price for living here, the facilities price, we don't have running water, electricity. But then the Intifada started. We call it the Oslo War. As my father, Zichro Livracha, used to say, and he came more than 70 years ago to build the first religious kibbutz, Tzvi Ratzvi, he told me, and he raised me on a belief that we agreed to pay the tax for living in Eretz Israel, not for us, for all the Jewish nation, for you for the second generation, for the third generation, forever. We agreed to pay the tax. But what happened in the Intifada, that we pay such a heavy price for living here. The price is very heavy. You live with it. You see the victims. You see the sorrow. But I must tell you, we are very strong. Never, ever we break down.
Itamar is a tremendous, tremendous idealistic community with very unusual people living here. Unfortunately, we paid a very, very powerful price when we had 16 of our members of our community that were murdered in different incidents. I myself, for many years until this day, have been part of the response team. And on most of these incidents, I was on the site of most of these terrible terrorist attacks. And I want to relate to you one of those terrible days. And this is a terrible, again, tragedy. A mother was preparing the house for Shabbat. She was getting ready to bake the chalot, the Shabbat bread. And at that moment, terrorists walked into the house, opened fire on her with her children in her arms, killed, again, the mother, three children, and the head of the response team were murdered in that incident. Not to mention that her other son lost a leg and another daughter was injured in the house. This is, again, a nightmare that one can never forget. And a lot of people mentioned to us, asked me after this terrible incident, how can you guys live here? How can you endanger your families? What are you doing here? And my response is then and today, of course, is that we know that the building the land of Israel, sometimes you got to pay a price for it. But we will never turn around and say we give up. God gave us the land of Israel for the Jewish inheritance. And nothing comes without sacrifice. Nothing comes easy. We have to work for everything we have. But we know that we're doing the right thing. We're following the words, of course, of Hashem, the words of the Torah. And we are building the future for the Jewish nation on this area.
But we continue. So you can find a lot of new boys with the name David, with the name Ido, one of our second generation who murdered, with new families who grow up on the idea that we are not going to live. And we continue. We are sad, we cry, but we continue, we smile, with the belief, with happiness, because we see the results of the price. We see our communities growing. We have new couples, new communities. And Be'ezrat Hashem, God is in charge of our life. He will take care of us. As it's written, "Ki lo yitosh Hashem amo v'nachalato lo yazov." HaKadosh Baruch Hu never will leave us alone and never will leave the land of Israel alone. He's always control our life, and Be'ezrat Hashem, we'll see the redemption, we see the Geula, b'imera b'yameinu. Amen.
Kindergarten, and we have most cute children.
I live in Hamad Gilad. My name is Yehuda Shimon. I work in Jerusalem. I have seven children, nice children. We come to Chabad Gilad and we build it. Now we have 28 families here. And this is the land that you connect to the God, that the God promised us, promised to the Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. And we are the son of Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. And because of this, we are here. And if all the world know and they do something this land, it was to the Jew, to us, it was a blessing to the whole world. Not just to the Jewish or the Arabs, it was the blessing to all world. And this is my wife, Ilana. My pretty wife. My lovely wife.
Now we are...
we cook to the Shabbos.
In 2 hours we have here a Shabbat, and we have a lot of visitors. We are living in Chavat Gilad, and we want to build a community that living together. We are 28 families with a lot of children. Living to build a community that we support each other, and we are helping each other with love and peace. And the revenge or the nechama is to build another house in the Chavat Gilad and to bring another children to the world and to live here in this land.
It was in 1897 in Basel, Switzerland, the first Zionist Congress convened with the goal of establishing a national homeland for the Jewish people. Indeed, they were successful. The early settlers worked hard to establish the roots of a great nation. So it came to pass, 70 years after the first Zionist Congress, that God rewarded the 70 years of Jewish perseverance toward their land. He gave them a gift. In 1967, he brought them into Judea and Samaria, and ancient Jerusalem, the land at the cradle of Jewish civilization. However, the original Zionist mission had stopped and was unable to carry the work of Jewish settlement into Judea and Samaria. Settling this land would require more than just physical strength. It would require people who had a special faith and trust in God. So it was, in 1971, after a struggle by dedicated Jewish souls, the community of Kiryat Arba was reborn on the location where our father Abraham had once settled. This set the standard for the next 40 years of settlement activity, which resulted in over 120 new Jewish communities scattered like pearls throughout the land. This was accomplished by Garanim, which are nuclei groups of people, setting out to create new communities. Because the communities were not conceived for the most part by ruling governmental entities, it truly became the work of the people. They successfully began to build communities and establish institutions of learning and set, for the most part, a religious foundation. Often the government would stand with them, giving them approvals and help build infrastructure. Planting trees and restoring plant life to the desolate hills became a major part of the people's religious and cultural endeavors.
When God created the world, and he put in Gan Eden Adam and Chava, the first thing he did was to plant a tree, to plant trees in Gan Eden. So we do every day, and especially in this Chodesh Shvat, we plant trees in the Gan Eden of Eretz Israel.
My name is Hananel. I am the mayor of Kdumim. Today is Tu Bishvat. It's a celebrate of all Eretz Israel. And now we are planting here with our children, students in the school, trees in Har Ephraim. It is a neighborhood that we plan to build here about 400 units.
Now, we're going to make a special blessing over the trees. Now, when we plant a tree in Israel, it's a special blessing. We do special things. Now, we thank God for bringing us to this very, very special moment. Because planting a tree in Israel is planting a tree on an eternal land, in God's land. And this is a tree that will follow you soul after 120 years somewhere else. So building a tree in Israel, here in Itamar, is a gift that is no price for it. And everyone else, gather around a pit. You got the materials. I have some knives that help you take off the roots if it gets stuck in the bag. We try to help you do that for you. And let's get to work.
Welcome to Netzer. Today is, I can still say happy Tu Bishvat, the day after Tu Bishvat, the holiday of the land of Israel, the holiday where the people of Israel, more than any other day during the year, connect with their biblical, God-given biblical homeland and say, this is our land, this was land was given to us by God, and we are here because it is ours, it doesn't belong to anyone else. And not only do we live here in communities, but we plant and we walk and we settle and we build. And today you came in an area where there is a struggle with our enemies who over the past few years, funded by millions of dollars by the European Union and other anti-Semitic groups, tried to take away our land. You are standing now between three different communities, Efrat, Elazar and Alon Shvut. The empty hills in the middle belong to the State of Israel. But to our shock and horror, the Arabs started taking over and we said, we're not going to sit by idly here. We are going to safeguard all the lands. And over the past few 2 years already, we have been planting, thanks to the help of many people, friends of Israel, who helped us financially for all the preparations here. We're talking about a tractor, we're talking about the planting, the upkeep, the water, and thanks to the help of so many people, so many volunteers, and especially the agricultural volunteers like Ori, who come from the Galil, abandoned their own farm for 2 days a week and come and work with us. Thanks to them, you can film all the different plantings here. Tens and tens of donuts here below with the white plastic cover. This is just one example. In a few minutes, we'll have this field, another few donuts. And we are here with Knesset member Ariel Eldad and with the rabbi of Gush Etzion and many people from Jerusalem and from Gush Etzion, Kiryat Arba, Hebron, and the whole area. Stating a very simple thing, the land of Israel belongs to the people of Israel. This is our land and nobody will take it away from us.
Today to Netzer, to plant trees, to follow in the footsteps of our fathers and grandfathers in the land of Israel, fighting for the land, holding the land. I am sure that as soon as more and more Jewish people will adhere to the land of their forefathers, the land will become ours, and we will be able to fight all our enemies, to stand against all the pressures, to withdraw from our holy land, and to make the land ours, not theoretically, but also practically. Thank you very much.
More evidence that the settlement movement has turned into a success story is the establishment of industries and businesses throughout Judea and Samaria, such as the Herbs of Kedem Organic Cosmetic Factory in Carmel of South Judea, or Biscot Winery in the Binyamin region, which produces over 100,000 bottles of wine per year sold internationally. But one of the best examples is the relatively new Ariel Industrial Park. The Ariel Industrial Park, in just over 5 years, has attracted over 30 factories and businesses in an area zoned for 60, and as of January 2011, when this video footage was taken, there were 7,000 people employed in the park. 50% of the workers are Arabs from Judea and Samaria, living in the villages around here, who cannot find such modern industry in their villages besides the good working conditions and wages. More businesses are preparing to come, for not only are there financial advantages here, but the location on the highway puts the park's location just minutes away from the greater Tel Aviv area. Products from the Ariel and Barkin Industrial Park, which is also located nearby, have reached international markets. Just as international powers have put great pressure to stop Jews from settling on their ancient homeland, so too many have put boycotts on products from Judea and Samaria, but have failed to stop the Jewish progression, modern advancement, and success in business on this land. The city of Ariel has become a showcase city for every Western nation, providing the best environment for a family to live in. It possesses a modern cultural setting and is now home to over 20,000 Jewish people.
Hi, my name is Leah Goldsmith, and my husband and I came to live in the land of Israel 25 years ago. We were looking to be pioneers and settle the land in its root, in its biblical and spiritual and strategic connection to the very beginning of time, and that is in the center of the land of Israel, in the actual heart of Israel. And we've been very blessed to live here. We have a lot of interesting stories to share with you, but I can tell you about a recent thing. So this was actually the first visit of United States State Department representatives coming out here, and we were very excited about it and very happy because, again, we're people, they're people. Let's sit, let's talk, let's clarify things. So the next day they came up. There were about seven or eight of them. They came up in their black Jeeps. They come down the stairs into my home. We sit down very nicely, we have a cup of coffee, and they take out these yellow pads and they want to start writing down information. I said, let's just keep it, you know what, I'm going to tell you my personal story. I said, could you please rise from your seats and come over to my living room window a moment? Yeah, okay. I took them and I showed them what I look at every day. I said, you're looking now into the Valley of Joseph. You must remember Joseph and the coat of many colors. And here to our left, if you could look into this little hill, this is the resting place of Itamar and Eleazar, the sons of Aaron, the high priest. And if you look up on the mountain where I'll take you later, that's the resting place of Gideon in the book of Judges. Now, I don't know how biblically, how you really know Bible very well, but I'm just recalling these people because they're obviously, the Bible is the best sold book of all time. I mean, millions and billions of copies of the Bible are sold, and they're speaking about these personalities. Well, I have a son named Joseph, and right now in the tribal inheritance of Ephraim, I have a son named Ephraim, and Jews all over the world, regardless of where they live, they name their sons after these people. So I just wanted to share with you where these people are from. They're from right here. They're from my backyard. So if you're wondering why I live here, it's because it's the most natural thing in the world for us to return
right here
to the roots where I live in the land of Shechem, where Jacob purchased the land, and later Joseph was laid to rest there. When the Jewish people left Egypt, they carried out the bones of Joseph. They carried the Ark of the Covenant, and they carried the bones of Joseph. And the first place they came to was right here in Shechem, between the mountains of Har Gerizim and Har Ephal. And Joseph is laid to rest in the place that his father, Jacob, bought. Thank God we started out as 12 families. We've blossomed into 200. We've taken over beautiful, beautiful land that lay barren and desolate for 2,000 years and have turned it into something green and productive. And this is the fruition of all the prophecies that our prophets wrote 2,000 years ago, that God will collect his people, bring them back to their land, to their original land, which is the land, obviously, of Shechem, Yerushalayim, Beit Lechem, Hebron. This is our heart. When someone writes me a letter, it's addressed to Lev Shomron. It's addressed to the heart, because this is the heart. So I wanted to share that with you.
We are now in the field of Machpelah, the Sdeh Machpelah, very close to Me'arat Machpelah, the cave of Machpelah, the tombs of our fathers and mothers, forefathers and foremothers, the place that Abraham Avinu had purchased. Actually, this is the first Jewish possession in the land of Israel, in Eretz Israel. Abraham Avinu purchased the field, he buried his wife Sarah. So we buried Abraham and Sarah, and Yitzchak and Rivka, and Yaakov and Leah, our forefathers and foremothers. All our history, all our identity begins here. This is the cradle of Jewish identity, of the Jewish people, fathers and mothers. Now the building, if you see this magnificent structure, this is a Jewish building. It's existing here for 2,000 years from the time of Second Temple by Cheney. Now this is the only building in the whole world which is a public structure being used permanently 2,000 years and still complete, no brick is missing. It's a worldwide phenomenon. And the Jewish people built it 2,000 years ago in the time of Beit Sheni, the time of Second Temple. Now later on, other peoples came and occupied our land and added additions. The Christians made their church, the Muslims tried to convert it to a mosque. You see the minarets above the Jewish structure, they tried to convert the whole place to a mosque, and they did not allow Jews in. Jews were denied access. They had to stand outside near the seventh step. Now in our generation, thank God, we returned. In 1967, the place was liberated, and now Jews can enter, and Baruch Hashem, we enter, and we dive in there inside our forefathers and foremothers' shrine. We are very, very close to our forefathers and foremothers. Actually, this is the site where we can get closest to our roots, to our fathers and mothers. And this is the place, this is the monument of Abraham. Abraham, father of many nations,
He actually gave the faith. He brought the faith to all nations,
and
to
many
all the
people
world.
From all over the world come to visit, come to pray, come to get closer to his personality, to his spirit.
Now, this place was a secret for many generations. People were frightened. People say that one who get inside will not get out alive. And many stories have been told about that. But we have got one opportunity to enter into the cave. It was in the middle of the night, some 30 years ago, and we opened the floor and we crawled down into the cave and we discovered the actual double cave. It's there, and we crawled in, and inside we found pieces of ancient tools from the Kingdom of Judea period, from about 3,000 years ago. Now the cave is deeper. The forefathers and foremothers are deep there in the deeper level of the cave. You can see here, we crawled in from this opening. We crawled in through a dark and long corridor, and there we found the cave. You see here, it's a double cave, because in Hebrew, Machpelah is double.
Shir la ma'alot Esa einai eleh harim Roi me'ayin yavo ezrim Ezrim me'im ha'ashem Ose shamayim va'aretz Al yiten lamot raglecha Al yanum shomrecha הנה לא ינום ולא ישן שומר ישראל השם שומרך השם צילך על יד ימינך יומם השמש לא יקקה וירח בלילה השם ישמורך מכל רע ישמור את נפשך השם ישמור צאתך ובואך מעתה ועד עולם שיר למעלות עשה עיניי אל הרים אוי מאין יבוא עזרים עזרים מאים השם שמיים בארץ אל ייתן למות רגליך אל ינום שומריך הנה לא ינום
Okay, we are entering the high school for girls Ulpenat Lehava, which is a regional high school serving Kdumim, Karnei Shomron, and other communities around Yakir, Revava, Elon Moré.
Hi, my name is Prome. I teach Bible. In this, you are in the Ulpena in Kdumim. We're a six-year junior high and high school that serves all the girls in the settlements in the area. And today we're finishing our first semester, and we're wishing everyone a great continuation of the school year.
I'm Daphna. I'm here from the beginning of this Ulpana, about 30 years ago or more. I'm teaching literature, and I used to teach also Bible. We have great girls here, very talented, all kind of themes and subjects they are taking. And it's the end of the semester, if you can hear, there is some music. And soon somebody is going to give them, you know, a lecture and something about the Hebrew language, because it's the year of the Hebrew this year. So we have a lot to say, and we wish everyone, everywhere,
a great Hebrew year.
A great Hebrew year.
Hi, I'm Rabbi David Feld. I live in Kochav Yaakov, am involved with an organization called Maccabee Institute. It's an organization that does chesed, loving kindness work throughout Yehuda v'Shamron, throughout Judea and Samaria. And one of our projects is located here in Kochav Yaakov at the girls' Ulpana, the girls' school. We help found the school. It's a special school where girls from all over Israel find their place, and they're accepted with love. Girls that are very, very academic can come here and they exceed tremendously, and those that are not as academic, they can come here and they're loved and they blossom in their studies. In addition, we have a program that provides hot meals for those girls that come from poor families and can't afford it. So we're gonna walk over here.
We started this project with 16 young ladies, and today we have close to 150 girls from all over the land of Israel and throughout Judea and Samaria.
Hi, I'd like to introduce the rabbinit, the principal of the school, Rabbinit Weitzman, Orly Weitzman.
אני מנהלת את המוסד הזה, את האולפנה הזאת, ברוך השם, כבר 8 שנים. ברוך השם, סיימו אצלנו 4 מחזורים של תלמידות, שהיום משתלבות בעשייה במדינת ישראל, בעשייה ביהודה ושומרון. חלק מהן לומדות עכשיו לימודים גבוהים, חלק משרתות בשירות לאומי. אם הייתי רוצה להתמקד בדברים המיוחדים באולפנה, דבר ראשון, ברוך השם, הבנות הן בנות שרוצות להתחנך לדרך של יראת שמיים, לקדם את עצמן, לקדם משפחות, בעזרת השם, גדולות, שמחות פה ביהודה ושומרון. הבנות, כשמסיימות כאן, הולכות ללמוד במכללות, באוניברסיטאות, ומנסות לתרום את חלקן בקידומה של מדינת ישראל.
Shalom, my name is Eldad Alachmi. I'm the Vice President of Resource Development in Ariel University Center. And here we are on the balcony of the President of the University, Professor Dan Meirsten. From here, what we see in front of us is the campus of Ariel University Center. Ariel University Center today has close to 12,000 students. And 1,500 members of our faculty and administration. This is the fastest growing university in Israel. In Ariel University Center today are 24 departments in 4 faculties and 2 schools. We're teaching, we have departments of engineering and faculty of engineering. We have social studies and humanities, we have health sciences faculty, and we have faculty for exact sciences, and also schools of architecture. You can see this building right in front of us, which is the School of Architecture, which is one of the best in Israel. To its left you see the complex of the Faculty of Social Sciences and Humanities and Liberal Arts.
What I didn't mention before in what we're doing here, we have here, which is also very, very important, 9 research centers. Those research centers that we have are dealing with a whole variety of issues, from cancer research center to brain research center to free electron laser, which is the national research center of Israel. All the universities and research centers are coming here to conduct their research in laser. We have here robotics and alternative energies, and I can go on into different fields. We're conducting here a cutting edge the research of our students and the students that are pouring in to come. And you might ask yourself, why are they coming here? And why do they even bother to come to Ariel, the heart of the Shomron, which is 25 miles from the Mediterranean, 25 miles from the Jordan River, to study here or to find their future here?
And if I can quote them and a lot of our faculty, they come here for two main reasons. First, because it's an excellent school, and I'm just quoting here. And second, because there is a spirit of, you feel the spirit of the challenge here. This is a new place, it's on top of the mountain, it's the view of the whole Israel here, and you're feeling that you're part of something.
I can tell you from my point of view as a person who in the past 40 years have been dealing just with building communities in Eretz Israel, that what I pray for every Shabbat, that my children, my own children and the children I educate will continue in our footsteps, I can tell you that I see the fruit. I even remember in this very room when my daughter Shira, whom you will meet, I hope, with her husband, Shivi, when they came and said to my husband, we are going to build a new community in Eretz Israel, my husband said, what's wrong with Kedumim? A beautiful place, pioneering. We went through so many difficulties. There are so many challenges here. So my eldest daughter, Yaeli, was standing here next to my husband and said, Abba, Shira wants to do to you what you did to your parents, what your parents did to their parents. Your parents left Hungary when they were, after they got married, they came to Eretz Israel with nothing in their hands. Then they came, they started in the dunes of Tel Aviv, so did my parents. And then when we had our comfortable home in Tel Aviv, we moved to the Bear Hills of Shomron. What your daughter Shira and her husband Shivi with their six little children, what they want to do is to continue to walk in the footsteps of yourself, of your parents, of your grandparents, and in the footsteps of Abraham, Yitzchak, Yaakov, and all the kings, and all David and Shlomo, and all the kings, and according to the vision, to the prophecies, all the prophets. So indeed, they packed the things, they moved from the first Jewish community in Shomron into a bare hill.
My name is Shivi Drori. I'm the winemaker of Gvaot Winery. We're standing now in the winery, which is located on the hilltop above Givat Harel, which is an outpost I was, Baruch Hashem, part of establishing 12 years ago. Three families. We went up this mountain, and we have very tough years building the outpost. And about 7 years ago, we decided going and establishing a winery, because after we planted vineyards about 10 years ago, it was known after a few years that the grapes here are marvelous, extraordinary good. So we decided, why sell the grapes if we can do very good wines by ourselves.
Workers are now transferring wines from barrel to barrel through you can see there, you can see one of our barrel rooms. The barrels are contained in this room in about 13 degrees Celsius all year until we bottle them after between 12 to 18 months. Okay, on the mountain you can see Shiloh, and you can see Tel Shiloh, where the temple was for 369 years. This was actually the center, the spiritual center of Israel.
Shalom, welcome to Mount Blessing community. I'm a farmer in Mount Blessing community. My name is Nir Lavi. Our farm is called Lavi Farm, Blessing Farms. We own vineyards on Mount Blessing that we planted at the beginning in 1998, and first harvest was in 2002. What you are looking now at and seeing is an enlargement of the vineyards that Mr. Rafael Kaufman has helped us organize with people from abroad, helping us making new vineyards in the Shomron. Now you see the works of the baggers and the trucks, they are smoothing out the land. The highlands of Israel, Mount Blessing, is 870 meters above sea level. The way, like we are the fathers of the land, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the same we are in walking in tradition with our ancestors and farming the land, bringing out the seven blessed fruits of the land of Israel, the Holy Land. Grapes, of course, is one of the seven fruits. And here it grows perfectly. We grow Merlot and Cabernet Sauvignon grapes for wine. And now we have added Shiraz, Petit Verdot, and Cabernet Franc as other kinds of types of grapes for making wine, for making blend of Bordeaux. We really thank the Lord for this opportunity so that we can bring out our heritage and our tradition to the land of Israel and continue a farming that was here 2,000 years ago and come back to the land. And now in 2000, in this year, 2010, revive the land and do what the prophecies were talking about. You shall plant grapes in the hills of the Lord.
And the spring continues. Despite some heartbreaking setbacks and the continued world opposition, the truth of the matter is that living in Judea and Samaria has become a mainstream thing. God spoke to the Jewish people long ago through a prophet saying, "I will rebuild you again as at first." So now, ancient communities and locations that are read about in the Torah and the Tanakh have sprung up before us almost without warning, and it has not been fully recognized. Communities and places that have been far removed from Jewish history have now suddenly appeared before us as proof that God is keeping his promise he made to Abraham, saying, "To your descendants I will give this land." Who could have known that such excellent Jewish communities were being built on this so-called West Bank land?
Thank you.
שיר למעלות אשא עיניי אל הרים רואי מאין יבוא עזרי עזרי מעם השם עושה שמיים וארץ אל ייתן למוט רגליך אל ינום שומריך הנה לא ינום ולא ישן שומר ישראל השם שומרך השם צילך על יד ימינך יומם השמש לא יקקה וירח בלילה השם ישמורך מכל רע ישמור את נפשך השם ישמור צאתך ובואך מעתה ועד עולם שיר למעלות אשא עיניי אל הרים רואי מאין יבוא עזרי עזרי מעם השם
And I hope you come here and you visit and see the beautiful people, beautiful lands, our lands, our